Kosmo. What's your actual function on this Clash tour?
Function. Hard to define. I talk to all the, or deal with all the people from the press and the radio and the TV. But there's a sort of, everyone gets involved in everything really to a degree. So it's, you know, you're partaking in everything really. You know, plans for the future and whatever may crop up while we're here and sort of meeting people. I suppose, you know, sort of publicist and counsellor might be a fair description. Actually, I sort of started before doing odd jobs, which I still do as well. But I sort of done all kinds of things, stuck posters up, packed records in boxes, you know, being a roadie. I started getting into publicity, working with Ian Dury, and sort of followed through with The Clash. I mean, a period for Stiff Records before then, they didn't really have such a thing as a publicist. They used to just rely on people, the mountains coming to Mohammed. But then when Ian come along, it sort of appealed to me. I'd seen a few other blokes who seemed to be having a real good time. They were called publicists, and they certainly didn't seem to work as hard as the roadies. So I thought I'd be a publicist. So I approached Ian, and he took me on. No experience, but he gave me the break just before the first album came out. Or practically at the time. I was kind of influenced probably by everybody around at the time. I mean, and there were, on one scale, there was kind of Dave and Jake were, to a degree, veterans. Mr. Chalk and Mr. Cheese.
Yeah.
And on the other scale, there was Bernard Rhodes and Malcolm McLaren, who were like, just ripping it all down, just that. Going really in the deep end, and they kind of were a big influence to me as well. I got a lot of help from people, you know, and just giving me tips. Well, I used to just go down their phone books and pinch their phone numbers, be honest. Photostat their 10 years of information, stick it in my inside pocket. Industrial espionage.
Yeah, how long were you with Ian and the Blockheads?
I suppose it must have been about 3 years. It might have been longer. I mean, there was a kind of a crossover period where I was working with The Clash and working with Ian, but Ian wasn't very active. It was around London Calling time. I mean, I had before then helped The Clash out once or twice, done the odd thing, you know.
I suppose Mickey Gallagher would have been working with The Clash around that time too.
Yeah, Mickey came sort of around that time. Yeah, he started to play along.
One of the crucial things about America is that, you know, how crappy the radio is over there.
Sure.
What sort of airplay do The Clash get there?
On a certain type of our stuff, we get good airplay. Police on My Back, Clamp Down, London Calling, Training Veins, I Fought the Law, that kind of stuff, Coca-Cola.
Mm. What sort of stations would play those?
The FM stations, you know, we've only had AM play on London Calling and Training Vein. But then again, once you start getting into the reggae side of the stuff, or Magnificent Seven, things like that, then it's a much less. Although, you know, we do tend to find that when the white stations aren't playing us, the black ones are. So there's some consolation. But then we can hardly get any radio play in England, so.
One other thing that I think has been interesting is the failure in America of that whole new wave push to be accepted by radio and the record companies.
No, but it will. We're going out there this year and we're going to take it town by town. Hicksville, Boyensville, Sleepyville. We're going to go to all them towns and we're going to shake them right up. And we're going to do it. We're going to do it. So it will change. Right. It's down to us to lead the way, but we're going to need as much support and backup from all the other bands and from all the other people in them towns to get off their arses and participate, not come down and show and clap their hands. That's not enough. That's not good enough to actually, you know, we can help and bring about a change, but we haven't got a flight case full of magic wands. one that says Melbourne, and one that says Tokyo, and one that says Paris, that we can wave around the town and it's all going to change. But you know, we try our damnedest, and we're expecting to see quite a progression in ourselves in America this year, because we're going to go out there and fight for it. I'll stay with the Clash for as long as I'm useful, and after the Clash I think I'll have a go at something else. I don't really see me contributing more than I could outside the Clash anymore, so I'll stay with them for as long as they need me. Not when I'm 40 though. If they're still going then, I think I'll bow out.
Is this the sort of venue that you like doing, or coming to a place and playing for 7 nights?
Well, for a start, it gives us a chance to meet people rather than just a quick fun. I mean a quick dash of the town and out again. Gives us a chance to hang around the town a bit, which makes us feel more like humans.
You get to know where the chemist is in places like that.
Help make friends and influence people.
Yeah.
Do our laundry and wash our underpants.
What's the inspiration that you seem to be drawing from American stuff now?
Well, we draw from all sorts of stuff. I mean, it's like stuff we like and stuff we hear all the time. Like when I first met him, Joe, that is, for our listeners, he was listening to Bo Diddley and stuff like that, you know. And I sort of really like Bo Diddley, but I liked him even more because I knew he liked him and I thought he played guitar pretty good, you know, so...
R&B.
You know, I've been listening to all that stuff before, and reggae and all that stuff. It's just that, you know, we started doing it as a group.
Why they've singled out you guys in, like, you know, the NME sort of credibility test and all this sort of stuff?
Because we're better than everyone else, really. And because we're so better than anybody else at doing it, that's why they pick on us and all that stuff. Because they think we're getting too big for our boots, and I think, because mine's still fitting his.
Yeah, but you have to buy a bigger pair.
Shh. Just because I have to wear 6 pairs of socks, I mean, 10 metres, so I've got bigger boots. I'm a load of, you know, bastards, because they don't know what they like, the music press. I don't know, it's a waste of time really talking about them, because, like, they don't know their back page to their front page.
Yeah, it's not a collective identity, is it? It's a bunch of individuals.
And what do they mean we should be out there organising? We shouldn't be out there organising anything. We should be doing what we are doing. And that's what it stands to the individual to do it, not for us to, like, rally everybody around. You know, how can we bloody make records if we have to do that all the time?
They live in comic books, you know. They think these writers are comic book stories, and, like, you know, Sergeant Fury and John Wayne running down Toxteth High Street. So it's not a comic book thing, you know. If the people feel it, they'll do it. And to hell with this.
Yeah, we don't want to ram nothing down anyone's throat, you know.
To hell with that.
Because gets boring after a while if I start shouting at you for about 6 hours about what we should do about the Aboriginal problem and all things like that, you know. I mean, like, we had a lot of that tonight for that geezer talking about it, and he had a lot of sense to say. You know, but it just goes to show, he said it in a light-hearted way, to a point, you know.
Have you found, though, that you've had dealing with that sort of expectation from the audience?
Well, I think it's like, especially over in Australia, they ain't seen us for so long, so their expectation is probably really big. They probably, like Kosmo said earlier, expect us to have magic wands and sort of go, douche, right, there's a load of fucking great clubs, and douche, all your problems are sorted out. And all that, you know. But it's all down to the individual.
A band that has sort of serious things to say, like yourselves, and when
you're too drunk to say them. Cheers, mate.